Eric, welcome.
Okay, thank you very much. We'll do it from here, it's easier. I prepared some slides and I think they will come up. I will look at where the technicians are. And some people in charge of slides. Oh, there's the person. Yes, there they are. Oh God, they are like in English and in Russian. That's good. Good. Okay, so they gave me 45 minutes, but I will use 30 because they want me to stop at about 1, and I tried to do that. It's a great pleasure to be back. I was here like 1.5 years ago for another forum, and some of you I recognize. And today, I will basically share my experience as a board member, serving on a board, what are the challenges, and what are the global trends indeed. But I will link it somehow to the discussion that we hear this morning. There are so many things said, but I want to focus on one thing. Where can we find the directors? I think that was the main, if I could understand it because I used the translation, but that was the main discussion. Where can we find them? And what are good independent directors? Now, let's assume that this is the board that I was invited to. And I was so excited about being invited to a board because, you know, then you kind of made it. You can share your experience. And so I did. And I, as a corporate governance expert, well, I saw myself sitting at that table and basically doing the main thing. You know, we have the shareholders, and we have management, and then we have staff, and we were sitting there right in the middle, playing a central role. And I think that's one of the key issues also of today, that the board of directors play a kind of central role in corporate governance. But again, they are not managers, right? There's this line that they should not cross. That was mentioned this morning, and I cannot stress that too much. And it's also very important, as we will see later. Now, what we do then, what was mentioned this morning as well, we serve somehow the shareholders, the investors, because they are too far away. If it's a listed company, if it's a non-listed company, well, they might, you know, need us to basically supervise and monitor management. And that was also the idea I had. You know, and then, of course, I'm also a lawyer, so I thought, God, this is great. Being a member of a board, you know, I can look at all the compliance, I can look at the law and regulation. There's a lot of rules and regulations these days that companies have to comply with, particularly if you are like in a regulated environment like banks or hospitals. And then of course you have the corporate governance, which is great. You know, I saw all the checks and balances that we have to do. And then whistleblower approach and related party transactions, of course not too uncommon in areas like this where controlling shareholders might, you know, use some related parties to do certain things that they should not do. And I felt so committed, as you can see on the right-hand side. I felt committed, I felt engaged, prepared. And of course, there's a lot of information coming to you, but thank God we have computers and iPads these days. So 1 week before the meeting, they will send you a lot of information that you can then read, digest, and discuss during a meeting. And keep bear this in mind, because they send a lot of information, these companies, to you when you are a board member. And I was so excited. And of course, I was there with my fellow independent directors, because the independent directors, as was mentioned today, are so important. And of course, board diversity is important. That was one of the reasons why they asked me on this board, because I happen to know a lot about innovation, about where the world is going to. And they said, well, you know, we also have to prepare for the future. We should not, we do not only live here today, but also the future is very important to us. Now, banks were mentioned, for instance, this morning. Well, if banks don't look at the future, they might not exist anymore in 10 years because we see all these developments in fintech, etc. So we need this. And I was kind of happy. And then, of course, you have all these committees, the Corporate Governance Committee, Audit Committee, Compensation Committee, Regulatory Committee, and Nominating Committee. And I was excited about this. And basically, I viewed my role as a monitor, as a supervisor. And the question is that enough? Is this what companies really need? And it's a very important question if you look at the selection of board members that we discussed today. So many of the panelists said, well, you know, we need to focus on CEOs and former CEOs because they can help you manage the company, which is true. You need them. But not all of them should be like this? That's the main question and the main issue today. And this is also the biggest trend that you see in today's corporate governance. We now came to realize that a board of directors is not only there to serve investors, minority investors, or the controlling shareholder. There's many more going, much more going on. And that's something that we have to realize. And this could help you with the selection of board members. Because so far, I think the focus is very much on people that have a lot of experience and can manage a company or have managed companies. And we think then about people with gray hair. Okay? Now, there was also a lot of focus on non-listed companies. And what I'm going to say today is relevant for non-listed companies, young entrepreneurs that want to start a company, companies already there for a longer period, family-owned companies, state-owned enterprises, and listed entities. It's all the same. All the challenges are the same. And what we see right now is that also investors realize that there's much more than just the compliance part and the monitoring part if you are on the board of directors. And this could help you find them, because they might be closer than you think. Okay? And they should not only be foreigners, although foreigners can help. But if you only have foreigners, then you miss what was mentioned during the introduction, the culture, the Ukrainian culture that has to be preserved and built in these companies. If you only bring in foreigners, you're probably not going to build that. So you need diversity across the board. Now, what do we need and what do we see in international practice these days? And that's actually these days. As I mentioned last week, a letter was sent to listed companies in the Netherlands. And these were basically the issues that investors want to see. One, the focus now is on long-term value creation. That's what we want from companies. We want the companies to be relevant also in the future. And one of the reasons that this becomes very important is the technology that we see. And I was here 1.5 years ago, which was June, it was a bit warmer, and now I'm here in the cold, but I see this little robot going through the corridor, right? So you see that robots are taking over. Probably in 1.5 years, this robot that you see right there will give the presentation just before lunch. Could just happen. Now, this long-term value creation is very important, and there are more people that see this. This is Didier Cossin. He is a professor at a business school in Switzerland. And he basically says, well, if you want to create a board that functions well and that plays a very important role, you should not only focus on the monitoring and supervising part. If you do that, you miss something. I think that's very important. That's also what I came to realize. Remember, I got to this board, and I was very excited as a corporate governance expert, focusing on monitoring and supervising. But that's not the only thing we should do. There's much more to add. And he said, well, the board members are there to co-create, to support management, but also to connect them to other people, to find the blind spots in the companies. Again, they are not the managers, but they can help find blind spots, because managers within companies, they tend to focus too much on one thing and they get blind for things that happen outside the company, and that's where independent directors particularly come play a very important role. By doing that, they create value and they help the company innovate. And I was so happy, and just to prove to you that this is an international trend, I show you this slide. This was 19-20 October 2017 in Japan. This was the OECD Corporate Governance Asian Roundtable, where, of course, the same discussions took place as we see here. In that respect, yeah, this is happening anywhere. It doesn't matter whether you are in the United States, in Europe, or in Asia. We all struggle with the same things. And this slide was shown by a board member of a company in Japan, which is a controlled company. Maybe not state-owned, but very much controlled, like we see a lot of them here. And this company, I love this slide, so I took immediate a picture, and now I use it as proof that it was only a month or two ago. Well, this is a slide in a bit more detail. And the board member explained to us what his role was in this particular company. This particular company is called Kaiteki. And Kaiteki is a subsidiary, listed subsidiary of a chemical company, I think Mitsubishi Chemicals. And this was mind-blowing. I really love this slide. So on the one hand, he said, well, you know, we should help companies focus on the economics. And this is basically focusing on shareholder value, right? Money should be made, and we are there to see that management is not going to misbehave, again, the behavior of management, so money will be made. But he added two more things that are very important and add to the corporate value. One is sustainability. Management of sustainability, because sustainability becomes more important. It's not this niche part anymore, the environment and giving back to society. This was all very fancy stuff that was discussed in the past, but now it becomes an integrated part of many businesses today, like energy, oil and gas, banking companies, all focus on that. So board members should also realize this. But the most important thing to me was the management of technology, the innovation. The board members were there to help the company innovate, to help the company find the next big thing. And this was mind-blowing to me, that now the role of the board, and this will make your discussion even more difficult, because now boards have a very broad role to play. And we see this trend anywhere. This, what you see here, is from the UK, September 2017. What we now see, in order to, and I show this again, in order to think about the finance of the company, the economics, the sustainability, and the technology, we have to bring in the board, not only the voice of investors, the owners, the minority investors, but now it comes, also the voice of the consumer and the voice of the employee. And this is more than just having an employee representative on the board. And Uber was mentioned this morning in the panel. The thing with Uber was basically employees saying that something was wrong. And then the consumer saying that something was wrong. Then, only then, the investor, and I can show you, only one very small investor wrote a blog and said that something had to be done. And only then the board stepped in. So it was first employees, consumers, investors, board. That's why we have to bring in the voice of all these people in the board now. Otherwise, we miss things and we get Uber situations. Now, this is from their report. You can download this, and I recommend you to download it because it's a very good report. It's a new type of report. It's a report with case studies, with best practices, not a lot of legal text. I hate these reports because, you know, when you read them, you fall asleep within 5 minutes. Now, this is one with a lot of illustrations. And here you see, for instance, the Royal Bank of Scotland, how they, with a simple chart, bring in all the stakeholders' interest. And it's they look at the commercial impact and the stakeholder interest now when they discuss things and make decisions at board level. So the board becomes very complicated, and that's how I feel it. I sit on the board, and again, they send me documents 1 week before the board meeting, and then I have to prepare, and all a lot of presentations, and all very fancy, and I have to read them, but now all of a sudden I have to think about all these things. So, conclusion, again, Professor Kosen, I kind of agree with him. Is it understandable, though, that in general boards are failing because we live in a very complex and riskful world? And I think this is a key issue and a key point that we have to address. When you see what boards have to do these days, and this is the international trend, it's just mainly impossible to find the best person. There's no person in the world that can help innovate, monitor, have management experience, know the law, can do all the compliance. It's just impossible. So we need a group of people that can deal with this. Otherwise, you get this situation that a board will never be good enough. And that's something that we have to focus on. Now, one way to do this, and this is the second trend. So the first trend was the value creation. But value creation creates some issues for boards, because now all of a sudden we have to look at so many things that we simply cannot do that. So the next thing is evaluation. Board evaluations is another thing that are being discussed these days over and over again. Because it's the only way for the board to see where they fail and where the gaps are and how they should basically complete this. You see it, second trend, board evaluations. Well, board evaluations, I loved. When I hear the term board evaluation, I said, yes, that's the key. This is what you get, right? You sit in a board, there's a new law, board should evaluate. And I thought, yeah, this is great, because now we can see whether we do the compliance right, the performance, it creates efficiency, effectivity, you see all these things, engagement, we look at each other, this is peer review, you and the board are basically looking at each other to see, hey, you weren't there, you were not prepared, all that stuff comes out, and then the efficiency of the board will be better. That's what I think. That's what I thought about board evaluations from an academic point of view, a regulatory point of view, and also the consultant point of view. I think, you know, bringing in evaluations makes sense. Well, how many of you sit on a board? And then there's a new rule that says, well, you have to evaluate. I can tell you what happened at our board. What the heck should we do? Here we sit. Do you really think that we start evaluating each other? I'm not going to tell him that he did a bad job because he will basically attack me back. That's what's going to happen. Don't kid ourselves. So the evaluation was kind of difficult. And then another thing, time. We meet 6 to 10 times a year with all this stuff to discuss. And now all of a sudden we get another thing to do. It's insane almost. So we were tired of compliance, you know, another rule that you have to comply with, and we have to look at all these other stakeholders and stuff. And we need guidance, and how do we have to disclose it, and how can we select it? It was on the slide, how can we select the adequate candidate? And I think this is the main issue here. How can we do that? Well, this was difficult. And when the rule only stated that there should be an evaluation, we simply did not know what to do. And what you do is the following, you look at other boards that you know, and they might have a report. You take that report, you copy-paste it, you change the name, you change the date, and say, okay, we complied, we did the evaluation. This is reality, which is not a good reality, but it's reality, because otherwise, how can we do all these things in 6 board meetings? Well, one answer is you bring in third parties. You bring in the consultant or the external evaluator. Here you see the external facilitator of board evaluations. Well, this is very interesting. I have experience with some of them. They never make mistakes. They just tell you how to run a business, how to run a meeting, that you are not a manager, and that you should, when you don't agree or you don't like one of your board members, you should have courageous conversation with him, which is all great, but it doesn't happen like that. And you know, we all forget about this as soon as we leave the building. It's a kind of problem, but this is also reality. So we need guidance, because otherwise what you get is that we have boards, we have a lot of rules, we have a lot of obligations, but what they do, we tick boxes, as I said, and this is also what data shows. The directors often see self-evaluation and all the other rules related to boards as nothing more than check the box, an annual pain point that has little impact and produces no change. And that's something we have to change, and that's something that can be changed. Because otherwise we get this, we have the evaluation of the former performance, how many meetings they attended, board resolutions and engagement, and how prepared they were. And everybody will then be outstanding and we just move on. So we need more than that. And I was just interested in this because I kind of believe, I exaggerate a bit, but only a bit though, I kind of believe that evaluations are important. And we started to evaluate and we saw that it was important, but we need something. So I looked at the data, just a bit of research in my presentation. I looked at the world's biggest companies in the world based on sales, profit, assets, market value, and this is called the Forbes 2000. And the good thing about these companies is that all these companies are kind of the darlings of the consumers, the investors, and the regulators. Everybody loves these companies. And what you see, here they are, 442 companies I looked at in 15 jurisdictions. I looked at all the annual reports, 2016 and 15, and I looked at how they disclosed the self-evaluation. And what I wanted to see in the disclosure is, one, why do they do the evaluation? Two, what do they evaluate? How did they do the evaluation? And the most important thing were kind of the results of the evaluation. And this is not the results of the individual board members. It's not a test. It's just, where are we as a board? Where were we? Where are we now? Where are we going in order to keep the company relevant? And there are some examples. Here you see one on the slide. I think the slides will become available because it's hard to see here. But here you see a very good example of a UK company, where they basically looked at succession of CEOs, they looked at the area of focus in 2017, they looked at the innovation, they looked at sustainability, basically all the things that were very important. Now, what I found is in order to, and this could help Ukraine in their discussion, in order to make a board more efficient, more effective, and also make the evaluations more efficient and more effective, you can do certain things in your rules and regulations, and basically your guidance and your best practice. So here we are, that not many companies of the old 1400 that I looked at disclosed anything, but the ones that did disclose, they disclosed why they did it, what they did, how they did it, but there was hardly anything about results. But the good things were that the countries that were best practice, best in class, and this is like UK, Singapore, and France, they were more explicit about what to expect from boards. So, main thing, if you want to change something in boards and board behavior, and I think that's what Ukraine tries to do, you really have to come up with guidance, not set in stone rules and regulations, but guidance that you update all the time. Meetings like this to discuss what are the best practices, how can we do it. That's what these countries did. They just came with a simple rule, which was clear and accessible. Well, you need to evaluate, but they all had supporting principles, how, why, and what to do, and how to disclose. If you come up with these rules, these best practices, similar to the report that was issued in the UK, with a lot of examples of companies that actually went through it, you have the best chance of making changes. Because these companies that are in the books are then the ones that deviate. And this is a very interesting observation, and one of the conclusions of the roundtable in Japan, that we just don't want companies to simply comply with everything and check boxes. We want companies to explain and tell a story why they do certain governance, why they have a certain board, why the compensation of the board is in such a way, and why that compensation could actually help companies. So, in order to build a culture of a good functioning board and board evaluations, you need to train, you need to develop, but the most important thing is you have to come up with best practices all the time that you continuously update during these meetings. And then you have a chance that slowly but surely you are going to make changes. This will not be overnight, but that's the only way to do it according to the research. Now, what you find then in the evaluations, if you go through them, is that there are certain issues in the boards that we see today that need attention. And I mentioned them already, they were also in the slide of our Japanese friend. One is sustainability and reporting. And there was a research being done by a consultancy firm that says, well, if we look at board members and we ask board members right now, what are the key governance issues that you have to deal with? And this is global. One, technology. Two, sustainability. Three, reporting. And four, talent. And this is exactly the point that we were discussing this morning. Where can we find them? And that's what I'm going to address now. And I need 5 minutes, so that's pretty good. Pretty good. So four things. And now, this is what the board members think. If you now ask investors, what do you think are the most important issues with companies and boards today? You get the same list. Technology, sustainability, reporting, talent. These are the things. So, one, sustainability. Well, everybody is key on ESG these days. You hear that term all the time, which is environmental, social, and governance. We all see that this is important. And this might be difficult to sell to investors because this might cost some money. However, as I mentioned, the consumers and employees become more and more important in decisions as well. And consumers particularly, they want to see some of this environmental stuff. And you have to report on this. And when you report on this and you integrate the social sustainability and governance, you discuss this on board level, and you report on this in annual reports, investors like it, consumers love it, and employees love it. And this is just an example. This was Royal Philips. I now work at Philips Lighting. We split the company, so this is the other part. But they won a prize last year for the best annual report. And the reason why they won it was that they integrated, and this is what investors look at, they integrated the environment, social, and governance, and all the other sustainability issues in their business and reported on that. And that's why the company is going up, investors love it, and you report on it, and you do a very, very good job. And that's what board members should realize as well. So when we look at the board, it's not only about the value creation and evaluation, it's also bringing in people that actually understand how to report and how to bring in sustainability in your company. And this is just something that you have to do then. When you discuss it, you don't only look at facts, but basically, as I mentioned, you create a story. So the board is there to create stories that show investors, employees, consumers, and all the other stakeholders where the company was, where it is now, and where it is going to. And when you do that, you basically create trust, the honesty, but you also get feedback. You show the vision to the world, and also heart and soul. And I just have a quote here of an investor that actually says that the companies that attracts most attention are the companies that are best able to tell a good story. And that's lacking with many companies, because most companies just check boxes and they forget about how to connect all the dots. So that's something, when you look at board members, what becomes very, very important. Then the last trend that we see in corporate governance and in discussions about boards is technology. And I mentioned that, and this is one of my favorites. When you have a board and you select certain people, this morning the focus was very much on CEOs, former CEOs, and people with management expertise. Well, yes, they are very important. But these are not the only people that you want to have on your board. We talk about board diversity, so we need both women and men, but also more than just former CEOs and CEOs and management expertise. We need, for instance, lawyers on the board to deal with the rules and regulations. Not five of them, but maybe one or two. These lawyers should not offer services to that company, right? They are just independent. They are sitting there to show blind spots to companies, right? To help them. But you also need technology specialists. And the self-evaluations, basically, that we looked at show that companies that have technology experts and innovation experts on the board are the ones that perform best, because they are the ones that actually see what is coming to the companies. And just to show you how relevant this is, how relevant technology expertise on the board is, this is just where we are right now. This is the exponential growth of technology. You see the red arrow there, that's where we are. But what's happening in the world is that we see more and more Internet of Things. We see robotics, as shown here, when you go outside. We see blockchain technology, artificial intelligence. We see big data. And if you have a board with no knowledge of this, you basically have a board that cannot help the company come from here to the future. And the future is very near. That's a bit of the issue. That future is very near, not only in the US or in Europe, but also here. That future is very, very close. And that's what we have to focus on. And just to give you some examples of how relevant this is just from Bloomberg, that robots are taking over oil rigs. And I really like the next slide, just to show you how close we are with this technology. This is a slide that shows you data from 2015, 16, and 17. What you see is that in 15 and 16, the number of employees in the oil and gas industry was decreasing rapidly. But so were, and that's the green line, the oil rigs. So less oil rigs, less employees. But now, since 2016, the number of oil rigs is going up, but not the number of employees. Why? They are completely robotized. They're completely automated. The oil rigs of today are just sitting there. There's no employee on board. Well, if this is the future of just oil rigs, I can tell you this is also the future of banks. fintech, peer-to-peer lending, blockchain. I don't say that you have to go into Bitcoin, but the underlying technology is very, very relevant to companies anywhere in the world. So when you look at boards, you need this technology as well. And this brings me to one of the things that I wanted to say this morning. When you look at board members and potential board members, it's very difficult to find them, period. However, don't focus only on former CEOs, CEOs, people with management expertise. That pool might be much broader than you think, and also with much younger people than you think. I don't say that you need a board with only 18 or 20-year-olds, but one or two, or maybe one, 25, or somebody who just started a business or is doing some research, might be very, very valuable. What do you do then? Well, you bring in some young Ukrainians on a board. You create a more culture about the board. It might be something to think about. And the data shows that this is very relevant. And to take it one step further, is there already companies in the world that experiment with artificial intelligence on the board. So this is a Finnish company, and they just appointed on the board Alicia T. And Alicia T is artificial intelligence. Well, if this is going to happen, you have many questions. This is an independent director. I just don't know. It's a computer, it's algorithms. But it's something that we see more and more happening in the world. So, what should we do? Oh God, I wanted to read that, but that shows the whole sentence. This one definitely doesn't show the whole sentence. So focus on the Russian part now. I cannot read it for you, but I know what it says. It says that if we want to have like the best possible board, you have to think beyond what we believe are good boards right now. We have to focus on value creation. We have to focus on innovation. We have to focus on sustainability. And that should be a mix of people that can actually help you. And then we co-create the future for that company. Because I think when we look at boards, they are not managers, but they help the company getting prepared for the future. It's all about teamwork. It's about skills. It's about success. It's about goals. But when we look at skills, it's more than just management skills or finance expertise. It's much broader than that. I want you to think about this. I want you to bear in mind these four trends that are very real right now in the world. I mentioned them again, value creation, but also by looking at all the stakeholders, not just the investors. Consumers get more important, employees get more important. Two, the board evaluations. But if you want to do a good evaluation, you need some best practices. You have to learn, otherwise you get some box ticking. Three, sustainability becomes more important, so we need more sustainability experts. Four, technology and innovation. And then the whole discussion that we had this morning might be a bit different and might be a bit more positive, actually, because it might be that we find more people that can help Ukrainian companies to embrace the future and make the world a better place. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Eric. Do you have gadget for translation? На самом деле я для себя услышал несколько, во-первых, замечательный доклад, мне кажется, во-вторых, несколько таких жизнеутверждающих вещей для молодых людей. У нас была дискуссия когда в нашем совете о введении, чуть ли не возрастного ценза. Да? Было вот мнение такое у нескольких членов совета, что моложе 40 лет не может быть член совета. Да? Какой у него есть опыт, которым он может делиться, да, вот. И, были споры, мы не ввели возрастной ценз, но вот видите, хорошие новости. Второе, вот для юристов хорошие новости, мне кажется, да. Поэтому, действительно много интересного и так ёмко в коротком докладе. Мне сказали, есть вопросы, пожалуйста, коллеги. Да, конечно, наших экспертов, но и из зала, я думаю, тоже будут. Микрофоны есть, вам принесут, только руку поднимите.
Thank you very much. Eric, thank you for great presentation. I'm your fan. Your last year's presentations were perfect. I refer to your case about agricultural manufacturer producer who engaged a lady from NASA to develop the strategy, long-term strategy of the case. Thank you for your helicopter view today, and I would ask you two questions. One is quite procedural, and another one is personal. Procedural question is as follows. I refer now to you as a professor and as a practitioner, as a board member. What do you think to have an efficient supervisory board with this, which is our second topic of our forum today? How much board members should vote for or against a particular question? Whether majority votes suffice, or it should be a qualified majority, or it should be a consensus, which of course is the best way, but sometimes consensus is not the case, and how the efficient board should meet this challenge. That's the first question, and then I would ask the second at once. Maybe it would be easier for you. A personal question. Could you share with us your personal experience and outline the most difficult question which you decided as a board member? Whether you, in fact, had in a majority who supported this question, or you voted against? Thank you.
Okay. I can start with the first question. The voting in boards. To be honest, I really never experienced real voting in boards. I think it is normally consensus. However, of course, when a topic is brought to the board, not all of us might agree. But in a discussion, we try to convince each other. We might not, when I disagree with a certain topic, but after discussion I might agree. So basically it's about convincing, and at the end we have a decision that we all believe in. That's my experience. If it really comes to voting, this is very simple. I'm a lawyer as well. Basically the articles or the procedures have the answer. Then majority probably will win, but I've never experienced it so far. We were always able to come up with a consensus and a real decision. And then what the second question was the most difficult part? Well, I'm not going to focus on one decision. I think what the most difficult part for me was as a board member, and I realized that when I just started, and I just mentioned it briefly, but this is what's happening. We have 6 to 8 meetings a year. You know, you really want to be engaged in that company. I get information sent to me 1 week before. It's all electronically, and there I go. I prepare, I read, and then we get some, some discussions. There are some resolutions already in the agenda that we have to take. But what I struggle with is, what do I really understand of this company? Can I really help? Is this what I should do? Management will present something. I believe in management, and I believe in management that we have, but they can tell me anything, and I just don't really understand what's going on in this company. We solved this by having meetings, because we have different locations. So we have the meetings in different locations. We talk to employees, we talk to customers, so we really go to the ground. And I can tell you, when you really walk around as a board member on the floor where things are happening, where the manufacturing is happening, only for 5 minutes, I learned so much more than all the documents that they're going to send to you. So this was the most important thing that I struggled with. And then I had a question, of course, you're really engaged. You have ideas. You want to support management. But how independent can you remain your independency when you are really helping this company is another thing that we struggled with. But we kind of solved it by doing the following things. One, we have committees that actually go to the manufacturing. We go to the floor. We want to see what's going to happen there, so we get a better feel of the company. And then discussions in the boardroom get also exponentially better. Other thing is that we also have a quality committee, and we do evaluations basically after every meeting. We just, so how did it go? Are we satisfied, yes or no? Because then it's still fresh. And I must say that these practices help a lot. And we share these practices with other companies, and some of them will embrace them and others don't. But the ones that do actually have the same feeling. So yeah, it's a consensus, it's collegial. And that's why one of the remarks that was made this morning, when you are a board member, who do you represent? It's a very, very tricky question. I think board members should never ask that question. Who do I represent? You represent the company. You don't represent particular stakeholders. I know in practice that could be different, but it should not be. Because if you start representing certain interests and certain stakeholders, you get a lot of discussions that you should not have. And that's something that we keep saying as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Joske.
Okay, once again, I'm from Kyiv National University of Economics, professor of management. And first of all, let me say again, thank you very much. And you know why? For the number of times you said future. It completely resonates with what I hear when we talk with Ukrainian owners trying to organize birds. Not too many future around the agenda. And what you have brought is just really important. I hope the people, our friends who took an initiative to create certain standards, qualification standards for future board members, will have something to reconsider. And that's what Alex already brought. He said, well, about number of years, about age, it's like it's old proverb. It's wisdom comes from years, but years sometimes come alone. And that's important. Let me tell you that we have these words like technology, sustainability, and talent. All those words about the future, about, we call it sometimes, organizational health, ability to generate future results. And my question to you, it's about your experience. Could you give us an example of the question you brought or you witnessed someone brought exactly about the future of organization? The question that had impact, please, the question which made number of people, the team, to reconsider something. Thank you very much in advance for that.
No, it's okay. It's okay. So, no, the future I think is very important to all the stakeholders. But your question was more about, you know, whether I have witnessed that the board brought in like expertise focusing on the future. That
yes, the question you personally asked or you witnessed, somebody asked.
Okay,
up to you. Thank you.
Yeah, sure. That's an easy one. One, I can give the example that was referred to in one of my presentations 1.5 years ago. This was a tractor company, agricultural, John Deere from the U.S. And what you would expect is people with management expertise, etc. But they realized that these tractors with big data can do so many more things for their customers, the farmers. And these tractors, when you connect them to satellites and all kind of other systems, well, their performance is going up. So what they did, they brought on the board a big data specialist in order to help that company go to the future. And why do you need a board member? Because that's the question that I receive a lot. You know, you need employees, you need people on the floor dealing with the innovation. The good thing about having somebody on the board thinking about the future is that it will show the blind spots to companies. It will show other possibilities. But there are so many examples. Examples on pharmaceutical companies, because there the innovation goes very fast. If you look at the boards of the biggest pharmaceutical companies, they all have professors biotech on the board. And these people just say, we don't know anything about finance. They don't understand the annual report. And this is very interesting. So, and this is from a book, actually. And then I will give my own experience. But from a book, this was what's happening. So here we sit at a table, pharmaceutical company with a biotech professor discussing, of course, the biotech professor was there to help the pharmaceutical company see the future. But they were discussing the annual report. The guy is not a finance specialist. We have the audit committee. But he was asking questions that the others didn't even think about. So what you get is that these, when you have a lot of diversity, even though you discuss things that are not their expertise, they sometimes see things that you just overlook. And this was just an annual report in finance. And they helped that company. And from my own experience, well, as I mentioned, I am sitting on one board where they wanted to have me for my innovation, technology, of future expertise. And that's what I do all the time. I just tell them, hey, listen, what you do here, that is a problem that you can solve with this. And then they start investigating, and that helps a lot. So yes, boards can help make companies future-proof. I have so many examples. I can sit it all day, but you will not appreciate that if I start, talking for like another 5 hours of, examples. Because then we skip lunch and stuff, we don't want that.
Okay,
so back to you.
Наверное, давайте еще один или два вопроса, потому что, по времени у нас жестко. Но Эрик будет с нами весь день. И вот я его приглашаю сюда, в это кресло, да, и он будет с нами. Да, прошу.
Thank you, Eric, for your fresh insights on the industry. My name is Alexander. I'm an entrepreneur in various businesses and a board member. Also in a lighting company, just like you, but a local one. I've got some future-related questions as well, considering this cute robot outside behind the doors. Thank you for addressing my first question about the first AI board member. But I just wonder, are we going to have a purely AI board in the future? Where do you expect it? And a more serious question is, there's a fresh tendency of innovation boards, yeah? For a technology-related company. Do you personally believe in that concept, or you still think that innovation should be governed by an innovation committee inside within management level? So what's your opinion on that?
Oh yeah, very relevant, very good questions. To start with your first one, will we get fully artificial intelligence boards? No, but I think many of the... if we have artificial intelligence, if we have a lot of data, I think the decisions that we can make at board level will be better because, the data is there and artificial intelligence is better, with dealing with that data. But that has always to be interpreted. And the interesting thing is that if you look at the next generation, let's call them the millennials, what they look for into companies is a kind of heart and soul, it's a kind of storytelling, and that's where people still matter. So what you will get in the future for sure, if we are back here in another meeting for like 3 years, there will be some boards that use artificial intelligence, but still the people are there to give the heart and soul. So it will be a combination. And the board members will use the artificial intelligence not as artificial, but as augmented intelligence. So it makes boards smarter if you get a lot of data that you can deal with. So you get smarter boards. So it makes the people smarter. Not with devices in their head, but just with the results of the artificial intelligence. Then your second thing, second question about innovation boards or innovation committees or the board. Well, I think an innovation committee in a company, yes, can do many good things, but that doesn't exclude the need for innovation at board level. Should that be a committee? Could be, but I think innovation should always be discussed within the whole board. I really believe that we have to be careful with all these committees because what you do, you fragment boards and that will take away the benefits that you get when you discuss amongst different people with different expertise. You always get to something better. I give you the example of the biotech professor having comments on an annual report. I think having just all these committees might be okay to prepare it, but at board level should always be discussed because, things are going so fast that you need to get everybody's view in the discussion. So if you really want to innovate, have all of them. But for sure at board level, innovation should be on the agenda and the future as well. But you are an entrepreneur and you look reasonably young, so I'm very happy that you're also on the board in Ukraine that shows that... Is he on the list?
Yeah.
Are you on the list? Are you on the register? Not yet. No, God, man, we
no
do it
yet.
Right away.
Not yet.
I'm giving a form right away.
Okay. Thank you. Коллеги, последний давайте вопрос, потому что мы уже немножко за график вышли. Что-то все с той стороны. Может быть, с этой стороны кто-то задаст? Нет? У меня есть тогда. У меня есть короткий вопрос, Эрик. Вот ответь, да или нет. Наш новый закон предусмотрел необходимость публиковать результаты оценки работы совета директоров. Self-evaluation. Публиковать результаты. Скажи, пожалуйста, эта практика действительно есть такая в Европе и в Соединенных Штатах? Или это немножечко неправильно поняли у нас законодатели?
If you want me to just say yes and no, or no, that will be very difficult. Yes, it's board evaluation and the, let's say, disclosure of the evaluation is in most of the... I did a research, I just... send it like 2 days ago to the OECD. It's in all the laws. However, you should be careful. When we talk about the disclosure of the evaluation, we don't talk about the disclosure of the individual evaluations. So it's not that people get a grade, you say that board member got a six, this is our shortcomings, that should not be disclosed. That's personal, that's confidential. Also, confidential stuff that gets out of the evaluation should not be disclosed. However, what investors want, and I talk to institutional investors, they just want to know, board, this is where you were, this is where you are now, what are you going to do to make it better in the future? And then you get some very general things, but they focus on some milestones, and then you just tell them, did we reach them, yes or no, and what are we going to do? You don't disclose any confidential information, but you basically help the investor understand what the development of the board is, and I think that's important. So again, it's not the individual results. That would be like the most ridiculous thing, by the way. Yes.